Welcome to our viewers in Nigeria and across the world. Lunchtime politics begins right now. Acting Governor of Ondo State speaks on Governor Rotimi Akeredolu's health status, says he's recuperating and expected back in office, just as a government refutes rumors that he may be incapacitated. And Benue State Asset Recovery Committee impounds vehicles as part of Governor Hyacinth Alia's directive to trace all movable and immovable assets from officials of the Otom-led administration. But Governor Otom calls it a persecution. And more appointments by Governor Alex Otie of Abia State as he approves 38 and heads of government agencies. But we'll begin with the call to rally round the Tinubu administration in its quest to transform the country. Well, that's coming from the Vice President, Kashim Shettima, who received the leadership of the 10th House of Representatives, led by the Speaker, Honorable Tajudeen Abbas, in his office at the State House in Abuja. Well, the Vice President says that the situation in Nigeria requires the cooperation of all citizens, irrespective of differences in political or religious persuasions, as well as tribal and sectional backgrounds, to support him. Well, the Speaker, who was speaking to journalists after the meeting, said that the lawmakers are looking beyond party lines in their parliamentary activities. Well, staying with the National Assembly, as the Senate is expected to screen and confirm the service chiefs appointed in acting capacity by President Bola Tinubu on June the 19th, well, this follows the reading of President Tinubu's letter at the resumption of plenary session by Senate President Godswill Akpabio. Our correspondent Linda Akibe reports that the Senate also announced some special committees and their chairmen.
I am pleased to present for confirmation by the Senate the four nominees listed below as Chief of Defense Staff and Service Chiefs of the Armed Forces of the Federal Republic of Nigeria.
Senate President Godswill Akpabio reading a letter from President Tinubu requesting that the Senate confirms the new service chiefs. On June 19, 2023, President Tinubu appointed new service chiefs in the country and named a former chairman of the Economic and Financial Crimes Commission, Nuhu Ribadu, as his new national security advisor.
In view of the fact that we don't have all our committees in place, this is hereby referred to the Committee of the Whole.
The Senate President also announces the much-anticipated chairpersons of the special committees of the upper chamber.
Committee on Senate Services. Distinguished Senator Sunday Steve Karimi will be the chairman, and Distinguished Senator Williams Echeng Jonah will be the vice chairman.
Done with the announcements, lawmakers face the business of a day. A motion is before the Senate on the need to investigate the huge expenditure on premium motor spirit under the subsidy under recovery regime by the Nigerian National Petroleum Company Limited, NNPCL.
NNPCL, within the period of subsidy, a subsidy exit attempt, substituted the term subsidy with under recovery without any recourse to the National Assembly or supervision by any other arm of the government. The Senate observed that while NNPCL within 10 years, 2006 and 2015, claimed that about 170 billion as under recovery. The same NNPCL within 13 months, January 2018 to January 2019, claimed a whopping sum of 843.121 billion naira as under recovery.
The Senate resolves to constitute an ad hoc committee to investigate the controversies surrounding subsidy and under recovery and also invite the Group Chief Executive Officer of NNPCL to brief the upper chamber on its under-recovery expenditures. Linda Akibi, Channels Television News.
Well, let's now bring you that meeting between the Vice President and leadership of the House of Representatives, where the Vice President asked Nigerians to rally round President Tinubu. Take a listen.
The day begins with a visit from the Gombe State Governor, Mohammed Yahaya. Speaking to State House correspondents after a closed-door meeting with the Vice President, the Governor states that as chairman of the Northern Governors Forum, he and his fellow governors will do all they can to ensure the narrative of insecurity in the region is changed.
Because of the encroachment of our grazing reserves, forest reserves, and even the cattle routes, issues have started to spring up, and those issues are those that catapulted to become, to result into rustling, banditry, and kidnap for ransom, which is very, very prevalent in the Northwest and the North Central. So at the moment, we are focusing on doing that, maintaining the peace, by providing for each and everybody and each and every sector.
Still looking at expected flooding and insecurity in the northern part of the country, the Jigawa State Governor, Umar Namadi, also meets behind closed doors with the Vice President, asking for his support as chairman of the National Economic Council on some issues bedeviling the state.
As a government, we are doing so many things. We have set up a technical committee of experts, and they are looking at how they can, in fact, they have submitted a report, and part of the report we have started implementing. We have bought two excavators, and also Hadi Jamara bought two excavators. As of today, we are able to dredge the river about 36 kilometers, and we have removed the taiga grass. And also, again, part of the recommendation of the committee is that we should do some embankment in the flood-prone areas.
Rounding up the day's visits to the Vice President is a courtesy call from Right Honourable Tajuddin Abbas, the Speaker of the House of Representatives, alongside newly elected principal officers of the National Assembly. The Speaker described the visit as part of the Unity Project, assuring that the 10th House of Representatives is looking beyond party lines as they focus on their parliamentary activities.
Come July 27th, on the last day of this particular session, we'll gladly inform the Nigerian people, our committee members, and our committee chairmen and the deputies. I'm sure you are aware there were some misunderstandings. They were just misunderstandings. We sent our list ahead of the time when we brought them open, and it was just unfortunate the national chairman did not see the list before we announced, but we really did that. And that misunderstanding was cleared later. So we are on the same page right now. No issues at all.
Meanwhile, a statement from the office of the Vice President quotes him as saying the president has proved his competence, his capability, and his commitment. I urge you, Right Honourable Speaker, and the esteemed leadership of the House to support the president in his noble objectives of transforming this nation. From the State House in Abuja, Kayla Megwa, Channels Television News.
Well, staying with the legislature, but this time at the state level, where the River State House of Assembly has approved a loan request of 200 billion naira made by the state governor, Similaye Fubara. Well, the loan request, which was contained in a letter to the House from the governor, is seeking the state parliament's approval to borrow the sum of 200 billion naira to fund supplementary budget. The request, which is coming on the heels of the signing into law by the governor of the supplementary budget, will see the state government borrowing the set sum to finance the proposed Port Harcourt Ring Road capital project.
Mr. Speaker, in the request before the House, the executive governor clearly spelled that the source of funding of this project will be by loan, and that they have negotiated a favorable interest rate for the state. Globally, loans are legally permissible as means of funding, be it private or public projects, by individuals, by corporate bodies, or by governments. state, local, or federal. So his deputy governor is within his rights to say that this project will be funded by loans.
The results before us, we have 4, 82, against, nil, abstention, nil. It therefore follows that the 10th Assembly of River State has approved the request of His Excellency the Governor on behalf of the River State Executive Council to seek the sum of 200 billion naira for the Port Harcourt Ring Road from any financial institution.
So that's what played out at the River State Assembly. But let's get deeper into this conversation. We're joined by Mr. Chidi Lord, who's the chairman, MOR, local government area, joins us live from River State. Thank you for joining us on Lunchtime Politics. I do hope you can hear me, because I know there's a major event ongoing right now in the state regarding the Ring Road project and, you know, some of the documents to be signed. So thank you for taking time out to speak with us on this all-important issue of governance, you know, financing, revenue, and the rest. Just before we get into that, Mr. Lord, you've been vocal about oil theft in that region. So let's talk about a national issue that came up recently. The NNPCL reported a big bust yesterday, and they've been concerned about the modus operandi of seizing and destroying that vessel. Summarily, you may have seen those images of the vessel being destroyed. Do you support this, especially with the possibility that maybe the crude was not offloaded?
Can you hear me?
Ah, finally I can. Please go ahead. Okay, we seem to be having a connection difficulty with Mr. Chidi Lord, the chairman of MOR local government area, to speak with us about you know, governance in the state. And yes, I can hear you, Mr. Lord. Yes, I can hear you. If you got my question, please go ahead.
No, can you call me again? I didn't get that clearly.
Okay, just before we get into the conversation around the loans, government expenditure, and the rest, I'd like you to speak to the national issue of oil theft, the recent bust that was reported by the NNPCL of that vessel and the summary destruction of the vessel. You've been quite vocal about oil theft and all of that. So I'd like to know what your thoughts are, especially regarding the destruction. Some are concerned that should the crude have been offloaded? Was it offloaded? Does that constitute a waste? What exactly is your opinion on that?
Well, actually, my sentiments goes with those who apprehended the vessel. But it could have been done decently. The contents of the vessel would have been auctioned to willing Nigerians who are in business. Now we know that the prices of the products have skyrocketed. Setting it ablaze would mean, to my mind, destroying further investigation as to who owns the vessel. We must find out who owns the vessel, where it was loaded, and those who are in it. But to rush to set it ablaze would mean to put paid to further investigations on the modus operandi of those who commit this serious crime against the state. I would like to advise that henceforth, when vessels are caught like that, it is important that they are handed over to the appropriate authorities to investigate and auction probably the contents of the vessel.
Right. So let's get into this conversation around the 200 billion naira loan. You are, of course, in the State Assembly quite prominent. A lot of people will definitely remember you during your time in the Rivers Assembly. So 200 billion naira approved for the for funding the supplementary budget, essentially for that Ring Road project. Speak to us from a legislator's perspective. Is that the most creative way to really raise funds for projects. A lot of people look at River State and they think, well, rivers can really pull its weight when it comes to revenue generation. So why resort to loans?
Well, I think the first is to look at the political economy of River State and to also look at the bane of projects. What have been the bane of many projects? Now, you recall that the governor of the state, Civil Life, has in a very iconic way thought about unlocking the potentials of the state and has conceived the idea of a ring road, which past administrations may have conceived, but lacked the political will to take on this very, very all-important project. Now, the Port Harcourt Ring Road will further unlock the state the way the former governor Yezo Wike did. All that he had to before Governor Wike came on board, Port Harcourt was quoted by Brookings. Brookings is one study institute in the United States of America that deals with studies on Africa. Brookings had named Port Harcourt, Lagos State, Algiers, and two or three other cities in Africa as the most unproductive cities. Now the emphasis is on unproductive. Why were they unproductive cities? Because you spend virtually the whole day, the productive part of the day, on traffic.
Right.
For you to get to your office, you spend 4 or 5 hours on a journey that ordinarily should take you 10 minutes. Governor Wike came to River State and has unlocked the city. So what Governor Fubara is doing now with the conception of this ring road that will crisscross 6 local government areas, including mine,
right,
is to further unlock the state. And this will be done by reputable company Jos Berger. The road will have over 6 flyovers, over 4 bridges, and so on. So
Mr. Lord,
200 million naira, yes.
Pardon me, just 2 quick issues, follow-up to what you were saying. It's ironic you mentioned Lagos and Rivers, quoted as some of the most unproductive cities. But when you look at the DMO's figures, Lagos is the most indebted. Now, if you're to add this 200 billion naira, which has just been approved to River State loan burden, River State will jump from 4th most indebted to 2nd most indebted with 425 billion naira. So, I mean, looks like a lot of money is being spent, being borrowed. But even from the report you quoted, there's little productivity to show
now,
for
you
it.
You must understand. Before a man goes up to take a loan, we have the capacity in River State to pay off the loan. The essence of collecting the loan is that we can assess funds rather than wait for every 30 or 31 days after the monies will be shared in Abuja. Now, if we get that, we will, because the former governor, Yezo Wike, has enshrined the policy of beginning and ending a project. It is not enough to embark on a project in River State. The loan will enable us to pay off the contractor. At the end of the day, the contractor delivers the project on record time. While we now,
so said,
based on the timetable that we have with the bank, we will not be paying off.
Okay,
so at the end of the day, when these 6 communities, including those in the river, are connected, you will
Oh dear, Mr. Lord, it's been very tricky really having this conversation, but at least we got some information, perhaps clarity on that project from you. But I'd like to thank you so much, Mr. Chidi Lord, who's the chairman of MOR local government area, speaking to us about some of the government's moves in River State, particularly the approval of a 200 billion naira loan for the Ring Road project. Thank you so much again for your time on the program. Well, let's head over to Benue State now, where several sports utility vehicles and vans have been recovered by the Assets Recovery Committee, set up by Governor Hyacinth Alia to trace all assets from officials of the Autumn-led administration. We'll bring you more details on that in a moment. Stay with us. Well, thank you for staying with us. Now, less than a week after the swearing-in of 16 commissioners into his cabinet, the Abia State Governor, Dr. Alex Oti, has made more appointments. So this time, he appointed 30 aides and heads of government-owned agencies. According to a statement by the Chief Press Secretary to the Governor, Mr. Kazir Uko, the appointment takes immediate effect. Those appointed include former Super Eagles International, Canon Wako, as chairman, Aimba International Football Club, ABBA, as well as a musician, Martins Justice, is popularly known as Jay Martins. You can find the full list on our website, channelstv.com. Well, in the build-up to the coming elections in Imo State, the People's Democratic Party in the state and the campaign organization of its governorship candidate, Senator Samuel Ayawu, has queried the Hope Uzodinma administration for not, in its words, doing enough to protect lives and property of Imo indigents. Addressing a press conference in Owerri, the state capital, the campaign spokesman, Gozie Nwachukwu, accused the state government of recruiting non-state actors to take over the constitutional role of security agencies in the state.
If you look at the inter-society fact-finding report that was released on June 12th, you will see that there are very strange dimensions and pictures being painted of the security situation in Imo State. That report clearly shows or alleges that non-state actors have taken over the management of security in Imo State from the constitutionally recognized security agencies and agents. Of course, that position by inter-society is also corroborated by a former Niger Delta militant, Asari Dokubo, in a very recent interview, where he claimed that his boys, in quotes, are now in charge of security in Imo. We now ask ourselves, under which law are these Dokubo boys securing or purportedly supposed to secure Imo State? And that is why we are calling upon the president and the commander-in-chief to please urgently set up an independent, discrete fact-finding team devoid of any contribution by Hope Uzodinma and his cohorts to come and unravel, one, the true roles, the exact roles played by security agents and agencies in Imo State, and be able to find out if they have operated within the ambits of the law.
Related development, a civil society group based in the state, the Imo Coalition for Justice, Peace and True Democracy, in a press conference petitioned the DSS, the police, the Chief of Army Staff and the presidency to invite and investigate a PDP federal lawmaker, Mr. Ike Agwonu Ugochinyere, who's representing Idato North and South Federal Constituency, for the term spurious allegations against the Imo State Governor.
But we want the necessary security agencies and the federal government and the president to immediately order the investigation of these allegations made by Ugochinyere Ike Agwonu. It is settled law that false accusation is an offense by Section 59 and 125 of the Criminal Code of Nigeria, and a fraudulent gimmick by Ugochinyere to cause disaffection and sabotage to the peace of this nation. We can state without missing words that Governor Hope Uzodinma is innocent of these accusations. Besides being a criminal defamatory statement that Ugochinyere made, it's an accusation of sponsorship of insurrection against the Federal Republic of Nigeria, We dare say that it is worth investigating. Someone cannot make such investigations and go scot-free.
Well, as well, former Vice President Professor Yemi Osinbajo has been appointed Global Advisor to Global Energy Alliance for People and Planet. Well, he confirmed development in a series of tweets on his official Twitter handle. The former Vice President is to assist the mission's goal of accelerating clean energy deployment in developing countries. He's also expected to support partnership with governments to enhance the enabling environment and delivery, or rather the delivery of effectiveness to unlock faster and greater capital flows into the clean energy sector. Just last month, he led a team of distinguished experts to observe the general elections in Sierra Leone. Well, let's now bring you that our lead story from Benue State, where several sports utility vehicles and vans have been impounded by the Assets Recovery Committee set up by Governor Hyacinth Alia to trace all assets from officials of the Otom-led administration. The chairman of the committee, Mr. Hinga Biem, while addressing journalists last night after removing the vehicles from London Line Auto Mechanic Workshop, which is allegedly owned by one of Mr. Otom's associates, says other locations have been identified as the recovery process is still on.
This committee was set up a couple of weeks ago, right? And we've been doing quiet tracing of the properties of government, both movable and immovable assets, but mostly vehicles that were bought between 2015 and 2023. We discovered from the records that most, if not all, of the vehicles that were bought between this period were taken away by some persons. And based on some of the reports, some of the security reports we have got, and some of the surveillance that have been carried out in a couple of places, we discovered that some of the vehicles are kept in certain places.
And reacting to the development, former Governor Samuel Otom, through his media aide, Mr. Tervia Kasse, says the Ali administration is persecuting him and all his known associates, even as there are records to prove that the past governors and their appointees are allowed to buy off their official vehicle to serve them after office. Well, that's the package for today, everyone. Thank you for joining us. I'm Kaido Kikule. Goodbye.